Now let's bring us up to now. Now we got all kinds of bad news. You know, you got, I got a house down in Naples, Florida. It used to be near the ocean. I think I'm not going to have to worry about getting heating oil anymore or whatever. So, I mean, you got the BP and you got the Gulf thing. You got this lunatic in North Korea who declares war on the world every week and a half. You got the Club Med. You got deficits everywhere. There's too much debt. You've got a shifting of the economic and political power bases from North America to Asia. I spent a lot of time in India. We own part of the Bombay Stock Exchange. So you're seeing a shift to these countries where you have a very high work ethic, and they're driven. They want to. They not only do well, they want to beat us, and they're doing very well. So I guess when you look at all this stuff, you know, it's like life. I don't know whether, probably most of you have had any major problems in your life, but those of us who have, they never come one at a time. There's about five problems come straight on at you, and that's the thing you gotta watch. And it's the same in the economy, it's the same in living, they come in bunches. There was a great football, American football coach called Vince Lombardi, and he had a wonderful line, fatigue makes cowards of us all. And you can get battle fatigue with so much stuff that's coming at you. I think what you have to do is try to discern what really is important and what's just noise. What can be resolved? What order you attack the problems? All of these concerns that I mentioned will eventually be resolved. In a matter of weeks or months, every one of them will be in page 5. I believe the things that are important now as an investor, a money manager, and again, I'm going to try to tie this. I'm interested to see how this talk's going to work out, by the way. It's the first time I've ever done it, so let me know if it comes together at the end. I'm Irish. It doesn't have to. It can just end, and I just walk out. So anyway, we'll keep on going here. What is important today? What is important now is, if I look at it, I try to simplify. What's important now is inflation is really low. Inflation is low. Interest rates are low. The economy is gradually improving. And there's all kinds of bad news. Well, all that means to me is equities are not overpriced. Because if there was all kinds of euphoric news, maybe they might be overpriced. But if there's bad news, there's not a lot of euphoria in the market. So the fundamentals are positive, and the atmosphere for investing is negative, which means I'm not overpaying. So that's basically it. So I'm an optimist, both for the economy over the next year, and the stock market. You know, if you ask me, I mean, stock market at the end of the year versus now is going to be up. Now, you can call me at the end of the year and say I was an idiot or whatever, but that's my best guess. Let me underline the word guess. So, lesson 6. Quell your emotions and try to use basic common sense to see what is really going on. You know, quell your emotions when you deal, when you do business, or anything. Get your emotions down and try to get a clear view of the world. And I think there are lessons for emerging economies such as Macedonia. Number 1, long-term investors require stability. That's lesson 5, okay? Trust. You don't trust a person, you don't deal with them. No arbitrary actions. One of the reasons we pick India as an emerging economy we want to be involved in is there is a rule of law. There is the essential British common law, and then they have Indian add-ons, which they change once a week to drive us all crazy. But there is essentially a legal framework, whereas in Russia, I mean, we can do deals if I have more guys with guns than you have with guns. But that's why we want to have, you've got to have a rule of law. You have no arbitrary actions. An ethical basis for a society. You know, when societies break and everybody's there for themselves, you have to make rules for everything. And frankly, this is happening in the United States. Like, I'll tell you a funny story. I take the subway. I have a car, but I take the subway to work because I prefer it. It's quicker, I have a nice walk. And I get on at the St. Clair West subway station. And I was, you know, when we had the scandal in Toronto, those of you who are Torontonians, the people in the subway ticket takers were all sleeping. Remember the pictures, guy standing there with their tongues hanging out? Well, I get in the subway station at St. Clair West, this is a couple of weeks ago, and I'm lined up and I got my token, and forget beginning to sleep, the guy isn't there. But everybody in front of me, they're putting their token in. I put my token in. The people behind me put. Nobody in a million years would think of not putting the token in. I was going to pay my token and go to work. And this happened this week as well. Same thing. No guy there. Everybody puts their token in. And that's what I mean by an ethical basis. Nobody would think of not doing that. Now, if that was New York, you'd need a machine gun there to keep people stuck. You know, forget that. They would go in and rob the booth too. You know, it's a totally different thing. So you know, no arbitrary actions. I mean, you know, a rule of law, an ethical basis. And the other one is debt is a killer. And this goes for countries, it goes for individuals, and it goes for generations. You know, many generations. I mean, I theoretically grew out of the yuppie generation of the 60s. And I took the benefits of the previous generation, you know, who fought a war, who lived through the Great Depression, and then I borrowed against my kids' generation, which doesn't bother me at all, but borrowed against the next generation so we can all live beyond our means in this one. And I think this is a very, very important one. Individuals, countries should pay their way as they go, and you borrow only for long-term projects, period. And that goes for individuals, too. You know, if you don't borrow money to pay your rent or have something else, you got to deal with that as it comes. So, and that part of that borrowing for long-term projects is also you have to separate what you need from what you think is nice to have. You know, I was packing the other day. I had to go to London for a couple of meetings, and I decided I'm going to get really, what do I need versus what would be nice to have? And I got down to a little briefcase, which is really great. Forgot my toothbrush, but. But this is a basic old country ethic is what I'm talking about, a basic old country ethic. Every one of our parents would tell you, don't borrow money. Every one of our parents, if you went back and you could ask your parents, they would tell you that. You pay as you go. Now, if you want to borrow for a house, that's a long-term asset. It's a different thing. And I think people forgot this. And you know, I don't want to pick on Greece here, but what the heck? Pete Foster would back me up here anyway, I know that. I was kind of hoping I'd run into him, you know. I kind of hoped I'd see him again. I haven't seen him for 100 years. But at any rate, what happened in Greece? When Greece had to borrow against the drachma, they would have to pay 12% on Greek debt. Okay. As soon as they joined the EU, they could borrow at 6%. So what did they do? Go out and borrow a whole bunch more money. I mean, that's what you'd expect from a 15-year-old. You know, so that's really what I'm speaking about. So, again, quality versus yield, that's lesson one. This goes for people. Don't cut corners. This is another thing when you look at a country. Don't cut corners. Don't shortchange people. A consensus value system is critical. A strong work ethic. I mean, this is what we see in India. I mean, these people work for 28 hours a day, and I mean, but they're driving. I mean, you make no mistake what's coming at us. It's a juggernaut, and I'm not even speaking of China. And well, I guess what I'm speaking here is a social or spiritual value of a culture and of a country. And it's those values that our parents taught us that are the things. And you know, I think for countries, location, neighbors, and size are all secondary issues. The problems of other countries around you, you know, they're opportunities to be different. You live in Macedonia is in a region of the world, lots of trouble, lots of aggravation going on. That's an opportunity to be different. And what makes, you know, because remember, countries and companies are in competition with each other. What makes you better? What makes you different? One of the great things about Canada is it's essentially stable. There is a rule of law. We're inherently decent. I can't romanticize it. We've got a lot of problems here, too. Trustworthy, compassionate, tolerant. You know, it's like the joke, how do you get 100 Canadians out of a pool, swimming pool? You say, would everyone please get out of the pool? It's one of the great jokes in America. They think that's very funny. That. But, you know, size doesn't matter. You look at Hong Kong. You know, Hong Kong is roughly the size of Skopje. You know, you're not talking size. That's a major economy in the world. So I think the key thing, though, is trust. Trust is the key selling point in all economic matters. Companies, countries, corporation. So all I could do as an outsider, is try to build on that pride and that persistence and that professionalism that even I, as an outsider, see. And the money will follow that. It's that simple. So thank you very much, and I'd be glad to answer or try to answer any questions.